Let me tell you the tale of Top of the Pops. Since 1964, every Thursday evening, Britain's youth would watch the ever-shifting weekly singles chart show on BBC One. With performances from the most exciting bands, all in the run-up to the number one song in the country of that week. It's fondly remembered, but that's not to say that it was ever that good. The performances were mimed to backing tracks, the vocals mostly lip-synced, and the presenters were as cheesy as the pop music. But despite this, Top of the Pops was a very big deal. If your band had got onto the show, you had, in some small way, made it in the pop world. It stands as a perfect archive of over 42 years of the British charts, and the performances still live on in the public consciousness. The first glimpse of Ziggy Stardust, the public debate over Culture Club's Boy George, the Battle of Britpop. But not all performances on the show went as smoothly as others. Some are iconically bad or shambolic. So who couldn't take the miming seriously? Whose backdrop consisted of an 80s darts legend, and who prompted 20,000 angry phone calls from a single outing. This is a short history of the best worst performances on Top of the Pops. One of the aspects that is synonymous with Top of the Pops is the mimed performances. This was a result of the Top of the Pops studio not being set up for live sound, and pop groups not being able to sing or play their instruments perfectly on cue. Pretending to do so was a necessity, but if you aren't a prefabricated pop group, that whole pretense seems very silly indeed. Ripe for parody. One of the first cases of an act sending up that aspect of the show was in 1971, when Rod Stewart appeared to perform Maggie May with the Faces in tow. While Rod's vocals are indeed live, by the solo, Ronnie Wood is making very little effort in looking like he is actually playing his guitar. By the final verse, they've all given up, preferring to have a bit of a kickabout with a ball that has appeared on stage. And who's that awkwardly wielding the mandolin? It's Radio 1 DJ and sometime Top of the Pops presenter, John Peel. After this performance, the pantomime was known, the bubble had been burst, and not taking it completely seriously was now an option. Coming in the aftermath of such defining glam rock performances as T-Rex playing Hot Love, David Bowie playing Starman, and any number of Slade appearances, came Mud, and their 1974 seasonal chart topper, Lonely This Christmas. It'll be lonely this Christmas, lonely at home. Guitarist Rob Davis is dressed for the season, decked out in tinsel and wearing baubles as earrings. The highlight though is singer Les Gray, who's brought on a puppet to do backing vocals. The puppet also managed to deliver the song's iconic spoken word section with a straight face, which Gray is unable to do.
Because darling, this is the time of year that you really need love. When it means so very, very much.
Despite the band not taking it all too seriously, the song remained at number one for 4 weeks. Punk bands had a love-to-hate relationship with Top of the Pops. On the one hand, it was the system and had to be raged against. But on the other hand, appearing on one of the most watched shows on television could potentially convert a lot of kids to the punk side. When the Stranglers appeared in 1978 for their top 20 single, No More Heroes, they had a bit of fun with the format. Bassist JJ Burnell spending the first minute trying to waft the dry ice off stage before an impressive no-handed solo from Hugh Cornwell. When the Boomtown Rats went on in conjunction with their 1979 number one, Rat Trap, singer Bob Geldof filled in for the visibly absent saxophone player by ripping that riff on a candelabra. Despite being one of the most frequently charting punk bands in the UK, The Clash never appeared on Top of the Pops. But the alternative was all the more surreal. Up until the 90s, for tracks that were rising up the charts where the band were not performing, nor had they a music video, Top of the Pops would get one of their dance troupes to do a way too literal interpretive dance, which legs encoded to The Clash's 1980 hit, Bank Robber. Alternatively, you could just get off your face before the performance, as Shane McGowan from The Pogues did prior to performing Fairy Tale of New York with Kirsty MacColl. Drunk, swaying, and completely unable to mouth the words in time. The rare old mountain dew, I turn my face away. Most of the time when something is slightly off with a Top of the Pops performance, the band is at fault. Not the case with an infamous Dexys Midnight Runners performance. Their follow-up to their number one hit, Come On Eileen, was a cover of Van Morrison's Jackie Wilson Said, I'm In Heaven When You Smile. Their coinciding appearance on Top of the Pops was fairly uneventful, except for one piece of bizarre production design. Behind the band as they played was a picture of a smiling, rotund man. If you were big on 80s darts, you would be able to identify him as Scottish darts player Jocky Wilson. The song is not referencing a darts player, but instead American soul singer Jackie Wilson. Over 35 years since the mistake, no one has confirmed whether this was intentional or a misunderstanding. Sometimes, though, bands were allowed to play live on Top of the Pops. Elton John, The Who, and Iron Maiden all played live, their musical credibility winning out against pop fluffiness. But New Order's first appearance on Top of the Pops, playing Blue Monday, was also live. It could be said that their offering is why bands were not usually allowed to play live. Simply put, it's a disaster. I thought I was mistaken, and I thought I'd heard you speak. The studio not being used to live sound creates this weird, unbalanced audio mix, with the increasingly wonky sounding synths overpowering everything. The MIDI sequences are also wildly out of sync with everything else. Bassist Peter Hook recalled to Mojo magazine, "We thought that was funny. It was anarchy. Saying that, one of the highlights of my life was being on Top of the Pops. It was the only time when people like my mother and relatives that didn't have anything to do with us thought that we'd made it." Generally, most bands appearing on Top of the Pops would get a sales increase the next week. Legend has it that after the train wreck version of Blue Monday, the track slipped down the charts the following week. According to the UK charts database, Blue Monday actually went from number 17 to number 14, an increase of 3 places. But as New Order's label owner, Tony Wilson, famously stated, when forced to pick between the truth and the legend, print the legend. Miming is easy enough, or is it? Darkly romantic band All About Eve were seemingly tripped up by this most simple of tasks. When promoting their single Martha's Harbour, singer Julianne Regan and guitarist Tim Buchano sat stock still as the track played in the background. I hide in the water. What had happened was that due to a studio error, the track wasn't playing through their monitor for the first half of the song. By the second verse, an unseen stagehand had alerted the band to the error, and so they began their extremely embarrassed performance from there. I felt safe and sound. Despite this, the track rose in the charts the preceding week, and the band were invited back. This time, the band insisted on playing it live. You are an ocean wave, my love, crashing at the bow. For a few years from 1991, the show adopted a live vocal to pre-recorded backing track policy. This would eventually be removed due to a vast number of acts being unable to reproduce quality vocal performances live. But before its phasing out, we got perhaps the most famous clip from the rock-leaning side of Top of the Pops, Nirvana's performance of The Smells Like Teen Spirit. Miming to the backing track, bassist Chris Novoselic mugs for the camera, and drummer Dave Grohl does his best impression of Animal from The Muppets. But singer Kurt Cobain, as always, is the one to watch. While barely playing guitar, he not only changes the song's first lyrics, "Load up on drugs, kill your friend," but croons the song an octave lower than on record. By the pre-chorus, he is barely audible as he fellates the microphone. Asked about it later, Cobain stated he wanted to sound like Morrissey. The performance ends in a stage invasion. The band would not be asked back. By the 90s, Top of the Pops was changing. Electronic dance songs, of which the musical makeup was samples, synths, and loops, rather than vocals, guitars, and drums, were visually not as interesting to reproduce on Top of the Pops. This was demonstrated when Orbital was supposed to perform their 1990 hit, Chime. The dance act's two members, Phil and Paul Hartnell, just stood around for the track's entirety, with the occasional button press. Whether out of spite or just because that's how they would play the song in a live environment, it's hard to say. The focus instead was shifted to the soul raver girl dancing her heart out for the entirety of the track, intensifying by comparison the lack of effort that the Hartnell brothers were putting in. Taking dance music performances not being entertaining to the nth degree were ambient house act, The Orb, in 92. Due to the Chart Information Network, the body that controls the UK singles charts, changing the maximum permissible length of a single from 25 minutes to 40 minutes. The Orb decided to release a 39-minute, 57-second-long version of their track, Blue Room, as a single. This charted at number 8, and the group got on Top of the Pops. A 3-minute snippet of the track was played over the top of producers Alex Patterson and Chris Weston playing chess, with Weston holding a toy sheep. And that was it. That was the whole performance. Said Manic Street Preachers guitarist Nicky Wire to The Enemy in 1992, "We're gonna set fire to ourselves on Top of the Pops." The Manic Street Preachers appeared on the show many times, but never did they actually self-immolate. The closest they got, metaphorically at least, was their rip through the Holy Bible's first single, Faster, when it reached number 16 in June 1994. They arrived in combat fatigues, with singer James Dean Bradfield wearing a balaclava with his first name chalked on his forehead. The song itself was described by lyricist Richie James Edwards as about self-abuse and had such darkly humorous nihilistic lyrics as, believing the band was showing support for Irish paramilitary group, the IRA, Top of the Pops got the most complaints they've ever received from one performance. The band were told it was something in the region of 20,000 separate complaints. It makes you wonder how many they would have got if they actually set themselves on fire. Perhaps the most glaring fuck you to the idea of professionalism is from indie band Travis in 2001, when they came on to celebrate their number 3 single, Sing. The performance is pretty by the numbers for the first two-thirds of the song, aside from a lobster taped to the microphone. But then a food fight breaks out, singer Fran Healing getting hit by a custard pie so hard he's unable to sing straight. Anarchy reigns soon after, with band members slipping over the place on Spent Cream, the backing track continuing unabated. Why did the band decide to do this? It was in fact to mimic their music video, which features the band disrupting a posh dinner party with flung pastries. After various format changes and moving the broadcast date to Friday instead of Thursday, Top of the Pops closed its stages in July 2006, going up against British television heavyweight Coronation Street in the same time slot, alongside an increasing diversity in watching options. Top of the Pops fell by the wayside. The last performance was Snow Patrol with their number one hit, Chasing Cars. Symbolic of the middle-of-the-road balladry that late noughties pop radio had become. Did Top of the Pops lose favour because pop became boring? Or did pop music become a whole lot less interesting without Top of the Pops backing? Either way, its end was an end of an era for popular music. The wide-eyed theatrics of Kate Bush, Morrissey from the Smiths singing into some gladioli, the arrival of the Spice Girls and girl power. No longer does the UK have a show that encompasses the shifting climate of the singles charts. And as such, Top of the Pops is greatly missed. The ups, the downs, and those much coveted number ones. Thanks for watching. If you liked it, like, comment, and subscribe. What's your favourite Top of the Pops performance? If you really like my videos and what I'm doing, why not check out my Patreon? It has cool rewards for cool people. I'd like to thank all my patrons, including October's new top tier members: Mass Effect Mafia, NASCAR Fam 1965, Rake Strutz, Trevor Crump, and Will Surrett. You're all awesome. See you next time.